Hello everyone, it feels so good to be back here and see you again at the ViteConf. And today my topic is the set theory. I know it's a bit random, but don't worry, I'll try to explain that later. So let me first introduce myself a bit. My name is Anthony Fu, and I'm a coding member of Vite, Vue, and Nuxt. I'm also creating a few open source projects, and I'm a creator of Vitest, Slidev, UnoCSS, VueUse, and Elk. I'm currently working at NuxtLabs on the framework team. So back to our topic. As someone who has been working on open source for a while and made a living, I have to say that open source is so much fun and rewarding. I believe that many of you wanted to contribute to open source or already doing so. However, there are so many factors that affect if an open source project could become popular or successful, depends on how you define it. For example, the quality of code, the documentations, the community, the marketing, and so on. All of them are important and related to each other. There isn't a golden rule to make open source projects successful. So for today's topic, I would like to share some of my experience and ideas on creating and maintaining open source projects, combining with some observations that I have learned from the community. Hopefully it can help you to start your own open source journey or find some new ideas to improve your existing project. This is going to be a series of talk, and today I would like to start the very first one of them. So today's topic is a bit abstract one. I'd call it the set theory, a way of thinking on planning the directions and the roadmap of your project. So let's say we already have an open source project or planning to create one. To be a little bit practical, we might want to gain a certain amount of adoption, or just we want more people to use or enjoy our hard work. One of the things to consider is how we're picturing our target users. For example, is my tool for end users or developers? Is that for Vue users or React users, etc.? So we know that the fact that among all of our target users, only a portion of them will become our actual user. In order to get more users to our project, we could try to convert more potential users to the actual users. Maybe by doing some marketing or polishing. In that case, the amount of target user you have actually becomes the upper limit of how many actual users you could possibly have. On the other hand, we could also try to find a way to expand our target user to include more people. Under this idea, let's take at some examples that how we could do that. The first example I'm going to show you is actually my first open source project back in 2019. The repo name is called VS Code Editing Island. It's a VS Code extension for helping Vue developers to working on editing, like preview translations in code or manage keys for each language, etc. This is a screenshot of the extensions that shows the basic feature. Well, the extension itself isn't our main topic today. At that time, I'm eager to make this project popular as I want to prove myself in open source world. I'm super happy when I got the first 100 and 200 stars on GitHub and received their appreciations from the community. After that, I started to seek for higher goals. Back then, I was dreaming to work full-time open source, for example, like even you. So my ambitions was to make something popular as Vue. Then I suddenly saw the fundamental difference between my project and Vue. They are directly reflects on the project names. Look at my project names. We saw that there is quite long and composed by multiple parts. Let's break it down to see part by part. So first, we know that it's a VS Code extension. So basically means that only VS Code user would use this extension. We could draw a circle indicating the VS Code user here. And then for Vue, because it's built on based on my need, then we could have a Vue circle as well. And then Finally, this is the helper for internalization, meaning that not all of your users would use these extensions, so we could draw another circle for iating. And then we find that our target users are limited inside the insertion of these three circles, meaning that only Vue developers who is working on an iating app that happen to choose VS Code as their extension would ever try this extension. That sounds quite limited. This is the phenomenon I call it the intersections. Before we dive into the solution, let's have a look at this graph. What would the other intersection mean? We could soon realize that the intersection between VS Code and Vue is actually Vola, or Viter at that time, the VS Code IDE support for Vue. As a result, we know that the Viter and Vola has a huge user base because both Vue and VS Code has huge enough community making the intersections large enough. Similarly, we see that the intersection between Vue and iating are the project like Vue iating, which are also super popular. So when it comes to intersection between VS Code and iating, we see that there seems to be no such project at that time. A straightforward thinking, that'd be that one, right? In practice, we could try to make the extensions decoupled from Vue, so it could be used by the other framework as well. In short, let's make it universal by breaking the set circles and expanding the intersections. And that's how I did. I took some time to do a huge refactor, design a plugin interface to make a core feature universal. At 1.0, I renamed the project from Vue iating Ally to iating, from a Vue-only extension to a universal iating helper for VS Code that supports a wide range of frameworks. Not say React and Angular, it also includes backend frameworks like Laravel, Ruby on Rails, and even native target frameworks. And they are customized and extendable as needed. So when it comes to number, we can clearly see a step increase of our stars at the times we're doing the release. The stars is almost doubled in a month at that time. So let's talk a bit about our old friend Vite. This is a story that's probably most of you already familiar with. Initially, Vite was an experiment on development tools for Vue when Evan first started. When the idea seemed to be working out, Evan decided to make a framework agnostic by extracting Vue's handling into a plugin and polished API. And then we have the Vite we know today. I'd say Vite's success turns out to be far beyond my initial imagination. It now has an incredible huge community and ecosystem. Basically, all modern meta frameworks are built on top of it, and the collaboration across multi-frameworks and communities are really outstanding. There are many other factors that make Vite to reach what it is today, but I would say being extendable and agnostic really widened the door for the community to join the contribute. The takeaway in this section is that we could seek for the possibility of breaking the intersection and make our projects universal. Here are some of the benefits I could think of. By making our project more universal, meaning we could reach out to a larger user base and naturally we would have more contributors to join the force and work together, instead of everyone working on their own solutions that's incompatible with each other. Trying to refactor things become universal also help us to revise our design and abstractions. And often we could end up with a more maintainable and extendable architecture. And finally, if your project starts to get more users' usage from various needs, making any improvements in our projects could end up benefiting anyone in the ecosystem. So we know that being universal has a lot of great benefits, But actually, being specific is also not a bad thing. One of the great examples I could think of is Nuxt. Nuxt is a meta framework that's specific to Vue. Out of many benefits of choosing Nuxt, one thing I'd like to highlight is the developer experience. In Nuxt, we provide quite a lot of features to help you build apps faster in a better organized way. We have server-side rendering for better userland performance and SEO, and file-based routing for better organization. We also have a powerful module system for integrations, and also Nuxt DevTools, etc. Many of these are built with the assumption that we use Vue and has a bundling pipeline. Nuxt also uses Vite as the default dev server and bundler, meaning that we inherit the great plugin ecosystem as well as the fast HMR from Vite. For Nuxt to be a bit specific than Vite, allowing us to bring many cool features and integrations that would be hard to achieve in a universal way. I think that's also why we have many meta frameworks like SvelteKit, Actual, Solid Start for different needs. And here, let's look into a couple of features that Nuxt provides. When we talk about server-side rendering and server APIs, we know that in some cases, we need the servers in some form to work together with the frontend. Other than a self-host Node.js server, there are also many services out there. For example, like Cloudflare, Netlify, Vercel, etc. To leverage the full potential of each provider, we might want to utilize the edge rendering and the serverless functions based on what they provided. One thing to note is that each provider has its own format. Some might also come with specific tooling. In Nuxt, we don't want our users to be stuck on a single platform. We want to support as many platforms as possible built in. So we build them and even support auto detection, so the app can be written isomorphically and deployed to various platforms without changing any configuration. And then we realize this is a problem that probably every meta framework has to deal with. And it doesn't have to be Nuxt specific. So we extract those into a standard tool called Nitron. It's a universal server builder, and it's pretty much like Vite, but for servers. With Nitron taking care of the details of dealing with servers, it actually allows Nuxt to have a more clear architecture for handling server-side renders and the APIs, etc. And since Nitron is a general-purpose server tools, we see more and more meta frameworks starting to use it, or new frameworks start to build on top of it. We have Analog, a popular Angular meta framework, has migrated to Nitron. Stack, a framework agnostic full-stack framework. Even without a framework, I also find Nitron to be very handy to build a pure API server and to deploy on the edge runtime. We also heard that there are some frameworks is in the process of migrating to Nitron. I'll keep it as a secret until they do the announcement. Similarly, in terms of the bundling tools, Nuxt 2 has built on top of Webpack. So in Nuxt 3, we want to keep that for compatibles and easy migration, while we also love the innovations and developer experience on Vite. So we try to support both tools interchangeably. We provide the first-party integration for both Webpack and Vite, pre-configured for Nuxt, so ideally the app would work the same for both tools. However, we know that the architectural as well as the plugin ecosystems are quite different in them. For example, if we want to add some transformations to some modules in our pipeline, that actually means we need to implement the logic twice for each plugin format. That would basically double our work, as well as the effort for community modules to support them. That's the initial motivation for us to create unplugging, a universal and unified plugin interface for both Webpack and Vite. With that, we are able to save a lot of effort sticking to the details or misalignment for each tool. And since unplugging gets extracted as a standalone tool, It also formed its own community and expand the scope to also support Rollup, ESBuild, and RSpec, and possibly more in the future. With the work done by the unplugging community, it also opens the door for Nuxt to start experimenting the support for RSpec as the bundler. And those are just two examples. We also have OnJS community that's providing many high quality tools throughout the entire JavaScript ecosystem. And we actually have Nitron and Unplugging as a part of the OnJS community. We also have a Vnode made from our server-side code executors and later becomes the code engine of Vitest and make it possible. Those tools are created from Nuxt need, but later we extract them and make them universal. They have formed their own community and ecosystem that can benefit much wider range of users and scenario. Nuxt can be the framework that's a bit specific by providing better experience, while the underlying tools can be shared and collaborate with other framework and the community. That's where make open source amazing, isn't it? So the difference from set intersection we are talking about, I'd like to call it the set union. We drag the universal part, expanding the scope to grow the community, and also will eventually benefit back to ourselves. So to wrap up with today's topic, we brought up an idea, I would call it the set theory, and it's composed with two sections, the set intersection and set union. In the intersection, we learned that we shouldn't limit our project to only be a niche spot. We should proactively seeking for the possibility to making the project universal by breaking the circles and enlarge our scopes. And in the union, we learned that even something have to be a little bit specific in order to achieve something great, we could still seek for the potential union that we could make to expand the community and benefit the whole ecosystem. And that's all about collaboration and community. I have a strong belief that open source will be the way for us to build a better world. And I'm looking forward to see more and more open source building with similar mindset. And that's all for my talk. Thank you.